The next category which we are going to discuss under the evidences of evolution is paleontological evidences. Paleontological evidences. So, what is paleontology? The study of fossils. Study of fossils is called as paleontology. Before discussing about all the other things, let us talk about something. The father of paleontology. Father of paleontology, Leonardo da Vinci. And father of modern paleontology, G. Cuvier. So, the father of paleontology, Leonardo da Vinci, sir, and the father of modern paleontology, G. Cuvier. So, paleontological evidences are most direct type of evidences. These are most direct of, type of evidences for studying the course of evolution. So, for this paleontology means study of fossils. So, फॉसिल्स हमें कहाँ से मिलते हैं और फॉसिल्स की हम एज कैसे जान पाते हैं, विल स्टडी दिस अंडर द पैलियंटोलॉजिकल एविडेंसेस. तो दीज फॉसिल्स मे बी प्रेजेंट इन द फॉर्म ऑफ जस्ट द होल स्केलेटन, दे मे बी प्रेजेंट इन द फॉर्म ऑफ होल स्केलेटन और सम part of skeleton or these are also can be present in the form some form of shells or some impressions of some animal or the impressions which are made earlier before in some strata of the soil, they are also considered as the fossils for the study. So, this is the about the fossils, and it is not necessary that these fossils are only about the 100 years ago or about 200 years ago. If we got any skeleton system or the part of a skeletal system which is 200 years ago, that is only the considered as fossil. No, but centuries ago or the thousands of years before or thousands of years ago, the organism which have been buried, and if we are getting that type of skeleton system, that is also considered as the fossils. So, the study of fossils is called as paleontology. And how we will determine the age of fossils? For the determination of age of fossils, scientists have developed certain methods. So, one of this method or the one of the well known method is carbon dating method. Carbon dating method, it was developed by Libby. It was developed by Libby. And it is not the most accepted, though it is most accepted, but it is only used for that fossils which were carbon containing. And the other fossils which were not carbon containing, their age cannot be estimated by this carbon dating method. And some more methods: clock of the rock method, here in the carbon dating method, we are using the carbon for determining the age of the fossils. In the clock of the rock method, we are using the uranium as a substance for determining the age of the fossils. In the clock of rock method, the unstable nuclei of uranium, unstable nuclei of uranium is converted into the stable nuclei of lead. The unstable nuclei of uranium is converted into the stable nuclei of the lead. Or जितने टाइम में ये यूरेनियम लेड में कन्वर्ट होगा, दैट टाइम इज द हाफ लाइफ ऑफ द यूरेनियम. एंड द थर्ड मेथड, पोटेशियम आर्गन मेथड. Potassium argon method. So this is also the most widely accepted method. Why? Because potassium is also present in many things, or in the many fossils the potassium is present. Therefore, like carbon dating method, the potassium argon method is also widely accepted. And in this potassium argon method, the potassium is converted into the argon. And the fourth method, electron spin resonance method. The electron spin resonance method, which is the fourth method, it is the new method, or it is the latest method for determining the age of any fossil. And it is depend upon the electromagnetic property of the electron when it is revolving in the outermost orbit. So this is the latest method, and it is the accurate method for determining the age of any fossil. Though it is centuries year ago that fossil was deprived in the earth, centuries ago, even though this method, electron spin resonance method, can find out the accurate age of that fossil. Now these are some methods for the determination of the age of fossil. Let us discuss types of fossils. Types of fossils. There are many types of fossils. The first, let us discuss, the first is unaltered fossils. The first is unaltered fossil, means aise fossils jo change nahi kiye ja sakte. Matlab agar that fossils are preserved in certain things, so they cannot be changed. They do not alter their form. वो जैसे है, अगर वो जैसे है वैसे ही रहेंगे. Their organic part or the inorganic part, that are maintained as it is. For example, fossil of the wild mammoth or the wool mammoth. It was of 25,000 years back, but it was being preserved in the polar ice. Therefore, it didn't change its size or it didn't change its form. When it was died, the same form has been preserved after 25,000 years ago. So, these kind of fossils are called as unaltered fossils, whose structure, size, shape, form cannot be changed. So, this type of fossils are called as unaltered fossils. The next is petrified or altered fossils. Petrified or altered fossils. So, these are most common type of fossils. Most common type of fossils we get. So, these are most common type of fossils we get. In this type of fossils, the organic part or the part this skin and all the other organs are being deprived or are being destroyed as they become fossil, and only the hard material or that are being preserved. The hard material like skeleton is preserved in this type of fossils, and all the other parts of the body, all the other organs of the body that are vanished, and only the hard part remains. Only hard part of the body remained. The next, molds and cast. This type of fossils, molds and cast, are formed when the organism is being buried, when the organism is buried in semi-solid medium like mud. When the organism is buried in the semi-solid medium like mud, then the whole body or the whole fossil, the whole organism is vanished. Pura organism hi khatam ho jata hai, and the only remains what? The molds. Sirf unka saancha reh jata hai. If a cat has been agar kisi cat ko agar semi solid mud mein agar rakha jaye after its death, if it is buried into the semi solid medium like mud, then the only part remaining is the mold. The sirf cat jisi thi waisa saancha us zameen mein reh jayega. So we can find out by that mold that what type of organism has been buried in that or in that mud. The fourth category is prints. These are also same as that of molds. Here also the organisms are being buried in the semi-solid medium, and in the prints also the organisms will be buried in the semi-solid medium like the mud. The only thing is that in the molds also, the molds are being used for the studies, and here the prints will be the study. Prints will be the fossil for the study. In this prints, if an organism like if the lion passes out from the semi-solid medium like mud, agar koi animal lion, say as that of the lion, agar wo semi-solid medium pe chal kar ja raha hai, to hum uske pairon ke nishan se pata laga sakte hain. कोई भी एनिमल हो वो, हम उसके पैरों के निशान से द प्रिंट्स जो वो छोड़कर जाएगा हम उससे पता कर सकते हैं कि व्हाट टाइप ऑफ एनिमल वाज दैट. सो दीज आर द प्रिंट फॉसिल्स. फिफ्थ, कैप्रोलिट्स, दीज आर द फॉसिल्स derived from excretory part. These are the fossils which are derived from the excretory part. Any wasteful material which has been present over anywhere, so that wasteful material can also be considered as the fossils. So these are some type of fossils which are being used for the study in the paleontological evidences. Now we will discuss about some examples of the paleontological evidences. Now, some examples of paleontological evidences. The first example which we are going to talking about is the missing links. The missing links, these are the links which are present between the two different type of group of animals. These are similar to that of the connecting links. As we have talked about the Archaeopteryx, which is the connecting link between the bird and between the reptiles, and it exhibited the features of both, some features of the birds and some features of the reptiles. It was having the characteristics of both of them. So that is the missing link, or that is the connecting link between the birds and the reptiles. Here we are talking about the missing links. So Archaeopteryx, it is the missing link of between the reptiles and birds. Why it is called as missing link? Because reptiles bhi aaj present hai, birds bhi aaj present hai, but Archaeopteryx extinct ho gaya hai. In this missing link we will discuss only about the that connecting links which are missed, जो extinct हो गए हैं, हम सिर्फ उन्हीं के बारे में बात करेंगे in the missing links. So the first and the foremost is the Archaeopteryx, which is the missing link of the reptiles and the birds, and it is extincted. So scientists have got the fossils of the Archaeopteryx that was pretty much good for the studies. Therefore we have find out all the characters of the reptiles which were present in the Archaeopteryx and all the characters of the birds which were present in the Archaeopteryx. So let us discuss some characters of the reptiles. Presence of claws, that is the character of that is the reptilian character, and free caudal vertebrae, this is also the reptilian character. And when we talk about the birds, the presence of fulcrum, keeled sternum, pneumatic bones, beak. These are all the characters of the birds which were present in the Archaeopteryx. And in reptiles, the presence of teeth. Teeth are present in the beak of Archaeopteryx. So presence of teeth is the reptilian feature, and the presence of beak is the avian feature. So beak mein teeth present hona, this is the missing link or the connecting link, the quality of the connecting link. And the presence of claws, birds mein claws nahi present hote hain. And the presence of free caudal vertebrae and the presence of fulcrum, keeled sternum. Keeled sternum, it provides the space for the joining of flying muscles. The keeled sternum provide the space for the joining of the flying muscles. So this shows that the Archaeopteryx is having the properties of both reptiles and of the birds, and it is the connecting link between the reptiles and the birds. And here one more, the presence of wings. So though Archaeopteryx was having the wings, but it cannot fly, it was not functional. The wing, presence of wings was not functional in the Archaeopteryx. Though it was having the teeth, but it cannot chew. Though it was having the beak, but it only has to chew their food. So this all characters shows that the Archaeopteryx is the connecting link between the reptiles and the birds, and it shows the evolutionary processes also and the evidences according to the evolution, that first reptiles bane, reptiles ke baad mein connecting link aaye Archaeopteryx, Archaeopteryx se evolve hoke birds bane. So this shows the evolutionary traces or the evolutionary links between the vertebrates. And the next connecting link is pteridophytes. It is the missing link between ferns and gymnosperms. Connecting link between the ferns and the gymnosperms. So the fern are developed from spore formation, and the gymnosperms are developed from seed, and they are also, they also have secondary type of growth. So the spore formation is also present and the seed formation is also present. So, and the secondary growth is also present in the pteridophytes. So it is the connect, the missing link between the ferns and the gymnosperms. Pehle ferns hai, then that missing link pteridophyte, and from that pteridophyte, after some evolutionary courses, the gymnosperms were developed. So this was the first example in the paleontological evidences. The second example we will discuss in the paleontological evidences is about the strata of the soil in which that organism is being buried. Strata of the soil. So the strata of the soil is also the paleontological evidences. How? Agar koi bhi organism kisi particular strata mein buried humko mila hai, ya us organisms ke fossil agar hame particular strata mein mile hai of the earth. So when we can find out the age of that fossil, or we can study the fossil because we can find out the age of that strata first. Hum pehle earth ke us strata ki age determine karenge, that in how, in which period or when, in which epoch that strata has been formed, or us time par environmental conditions kya the, what happened or what geographical disturbances happened at that time, so these animals were died and they become fossils and they buried in that particular strata. सो अगर कोई भी ऑर्गेनिज्म हमें किसी भी स्ट्रेटा से, सॉइल के किसी भी स्ट्रेटा से अगर मिल रहा है, देन आफ्टर फाइंडिंग द एज ऑफ दैट स्ट्रेटा ऑफ द सॉइल, वी कैन ऑल्सो फाइंड आउट द एज ऑफ दैट फॉसिल एंड वी कैन ऑल्सो स्टडी अबाउट द कैरेक्टर्स ऑफ दिस फॉसिल्स. सो दिस वॉज द सेकेंड एग्जाम्पल, द स्ट्रेटा ऑफ द सॉइल. द थर्ड एग्जाम्पल वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस इज अबाउट द फाइलोजेनी ऑफ हॉर्स. फाइलोजेनी ऑफ हॉर्स, इन दिस वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट द एंसेस्ट्रल चेंजेस इन द हॉर्स, अबाउट द फाइलोजेनेटिक इवोल्यूशन ऑफ द हॉर्स. We all know that we get the evidences of the evolution from the paleontological evidence. It is the most direct type of evidence. So, for study of the fossils also, हमें वो fossil कुछ अच्छी condition में भी मिलना चाहिए. That fossil should be in the pretty good condition so that we can study. Like Archaeopteryx, हमें Archaeopteryx का और साइंटिस्ट को Archaeopteryx का पूरा स्केलेटल स्ट्रक्चर मिला था. Therefore, we can determine the characters of both the reptiles and the birds. Likewise, scientists also get the good fossils of the horses also. So, by combining or by preparing all that fossils from the ancestors towards the modern fossils, we have determined a phylogenetic tree or the phylogenetic sequences about the evolution of the horse that we are going to discuss now. This is the phylogeny of the horse, is the third example of the paleontological evidences. These are the certain factual things that they are present. We will discuss about these things which have been evolved by the course of time, the fingers, toes and molars. So, before discussing about this phylogeny of horse, let us discuss about the evolution or the geological time scale in brief. Later on we will discuss afterwards in detail about the geological time scale. Why we are discussing here the geological time scale? Because the Eohippus, these all horses or the evolutionary course of horses have been seen in these epochs. So to understand the significance of these epochs, we have to first understand the geological time scale, that what are these epochs and why they are being used here. So, geological time scale. To explain the geological time scale, or while the geological time scale was being designed, the whole history of the earth has been divided into 6 eras. अर्थ की पूरी हिस्ट्री को 6 एराज में डिवाइड किया गया फॉर स्टडिंग द जियोलॉजिकल टाइम स्केल. तो व्हाट आर दीज 6 एराज? एजोइक एरा, आर्कियोजोइक एरा, प्रोटेरोजोइक एरा, पेलियोजोइक एरा मीजोजोइक एरा एंड एजोइक एरा, आर्कियोजोइक एरा, प्रोटेरोजोइक, पेलियोजोइक, मीजोजोइक एंड सीनोजोइक एरा. These are the 6 eras in which the whole history of the earth has been divided to study the geological time scales. And further, these eras has been divided into periods. Only the last three eras, the Paleozoic era, Mesozoic era and Cenozoic era, only the last three eras has been divided into the periods, and the further division of the periods is epochs. These are called as epochs. The six eras for dividing the whole history of the earth, and the division of eras is periods, and periods are being are the division of the only last three eras, that is the Paleozoic era, Mesozoic era and Cenozoic era. Then the further division of these periods are epochs, and these are the epochs: Eocene, Oligocene, Miocene, Pliocene and Pleistocene. These are certain epochs which are the divisions of that periods. So, phylogeny of horse. The first horse, the primitive or the ancestral horse, which was present around 60 million years ago, the first fossil which we have got about the horse was Eohippus. The common name of Eohippus is Dawn horse because it was the first horse. It was found in the Eocene epoch and its age is around 60 million years and its height is 28 centimeters. Only 28 centimeters its height was. The second, Mesohippus. Its common name is intermediate horse and it was found in the Oligocene epoch. It is 40 million years in age and 60 centimeters its height. Now, Merihippus, it is also called as ruminating horse, or the common name of the Merihippus is ruminating horse. It is found in the Mesocene epoch and its age is 25 million years and height is 100 centimeter. See, gradually the height is increasing from 28 centimeter to 60 centimeter to 100 centimeter. Now, the Pliohippus, the fourth category of the horse, Pliocene horse, the common name of Pliohippus, epoch, Pliocene epoch, the Pliohippus has been found in the Pliocene epoch. The age is 10 million years and its height is 108 centimeters. The modern horse, that is Equus, it is found in the Pleistocene or the latest epoch. The Pleistocene in which the latest epoch in which we are living, and the Cenozoic era, the Pleistocene is the epoch of the Cenozoic era. So, this is the epoch of the origin of the modern horse, and the age of the modern horse is 0.5 million years and the height is 150 centimeters. So, when we are talking about the fingers of first, that is Eohippus or the Dawn horse, in this four fingers, only four fingers were functional. Four fingers were functional in the Eohippus, only four fingers were functional. And if we talk about the five phalanges, agar hum panch phalanges ki baat kare, to isme sirf char hi phalanges present hai, ya char hi fingers present hai. And one reduced, first one finger reduced to the splint bone. And when we talk about the toes, only three were functional. And the two were splint. When we talk about the molars, if this is the structure of the teeth, when we talk about the molars, so the cap or the tooth cap is very small in size. Small size of truth cap is present in this. So these are the fingers, only four fingers were present. The one was reduced to the splint bones. In toes, only three fingers were functional, two were reduced to the splint bones, and in the molars they have the small type of teeth, small teeth were present. And in the second category, that is mesohippus, in mesohippus the same was found, that is when we talk about the fingers, the three fingers were functional. Ab mesohippus mein three fingers functional hue, to two fingers splint bones mein convert ho gaye. First and fifth were converted into the splint bones, and the same in the toes. Three were functional and two were splint, and the molars were also same. Now when we talk about the merychippus horse, so in the merychippus horse the three is in this all the only the third finger was functional. Here only the third finger remained functional and all others was 1, 2, 4 and 5, they were all converted into the splint bones. Third wali hi sirf rahi usme, third wali hi functional rahi, and first, second, fourth and fifth were converted into the splint bone. The same in the toes, when we talk about the toes, only the third toe remain functional and all the others were splinted. And when we talk about the molars, they increased their size. Molars increased their size and they appears to be like grazing molars. So this shows that from here, yahan se grasses aane lagi. So when grasses are present, horse started grazing that grasses, and the size of their teeth or the size of their molars increases and they become the grazing molars. When let us draw a diagram about the fingers or the splint bones of the horse. This is the third finger. So when it is the third finger and we are talking about the eohippus, the first one, if we'll talk about the second one, that is the mesohippus, if it is the third finger which is developed and the first and the fifth are being not developed. This is third one, this is second one, and it is fourth, and first and fifth are present like this. This is the first and this is fifth. And when we talk about the ruminating horse, so in this the structure will be like this. Only the third one is functional and first, second, fourth and fifth are converted into the splint bones. This is the structure of the finger. When the bones get splinted and only one finger remains in the horse. And next, pleohippus. In the pleohippus also the same, the third one will continue, the third one will become highly developed and all the splinted bone as it is. Here also the third one highly developed and the same grazing teeth. In last, that is equus, in the modern horse the third becomes more and more developed. The third finger is more and more developed, and the splinted, that is first, second, fourth and fifth, all the splinted bones are also the in the same manner. And when we talk about the toes, the third one is highly developed and is splinted as it is, and the molars also as it is. So this is the phylogeny of the horse. Eohippus, Dor horse, Eocene having four fingers, one splinted bone, and in the toes three were functional, two were splinted and molars were small. When we talk about the Mesohippus, they were intermediate horse, Oligocene, three fingers were functional, two were splinted, and in the toes the same, the three were functional and two splinted, and molars were also same, small size. And in the Merychippus, ruminating type of horse found in Mesocene era, only third finger were remained for being functional, and all the other bones were splinted. First, second, fourth and fifth were splinted in this. And in the, when we talk about the toes, only the third was functional and all the other get splinted. Now in this Merychippus, the molars were very much developed and the horse started grazing. Pleohippus, Pleocene horse, the epoch is Pleocene, and the third will become highly developed, the third finger is highly developed, third toe is also highly developed, and molars were same as that of the grazing. And in the modern horse Equus, the third toe or the third finger were very much developed, that only that is remaining and all the others were splinted, and it was and the molars were having the large size of molars were present for grazing of the for grazing purposes, for grazing of grasses. So this was all about the phylogeny of horse, and we have completed here our two evidences of evolution categorized in, first one, morphological and anatomical evidences, in which we have talked about the homologous, analogous organs, vestigial organs, atavism and connecting links. And in the paleontological evidences, we have talked about the types of fossils and the methods for determination of the age of the fossils. And in when we talk about the examples, we have taken the example of Archaeopteryx, that is missing link, Archaeopteryx and pteridophytes, which is the missing link between the ferns and the gymnosperms, and the strata of the soil, and the third example, which is very important about the phylogeny of the horse.